During this difficult period, Barry and Robin became fathers for the first time. But Morris's marriage to Lulu was crumbling.
And when you spend 6 years of your life with somebody, it's like really weird all of a sudden you're driving around in your car with your bags in it and the dog on the front seat. You know, it's like very strange. So naturally, I turned to more drinking.
In late 1974, the Bee Gees began performing on the British nightclub circuit. One of the venues they played was Batley's Variety Club, where Morris met Yvonne Spenceley.
I just saw her eyes, and I said, I'm going to marry her.
I think what came across more than anything was the warmth that he had. I thought, oh, what a really sweet guy he seems to be, you know? And I think that's what came across more than anything else, apart from him being talented, of course. I think that attracted me to him, and he was really cute.
Besides the innocence, I saw a lot of strength. She's very compassionate.
He's very romantic. Very sweet.
Oh, definitely, without question, the best thing I've ever done is marry Yvonne. Without a doubt.
As 1974 gave way to 1975, the Bee Gees were ready for a new beginning. Their old friend, Eric Clapton, then on the verge of a comeback of his own, suggested that the brothers try Miami's Criteria Studios. With Arif Martin again producing, they started recording a new album.
We were on our way back from the studio, and every time you leave Criteria, there's a bridge, and the bridge is rickety, and it makes a noise when you go over it. And every night, I'd hear the same thing. That ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch. And I'd hear it every night. And so one night, we went over there, and the car must have been traveling at a certain speed, and the rhythm felt really right. And I just started singing along with it. And it just became, you know, ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch- I don't know where the term jive talking came from, that just sort of popped into my head. As is what usually happens if I have an idea for a song. It's not something I ask for, it just comes. And this was something, and I thought, wait, I gotta sing this tomorrow from Rob when I get home. I sang the idea to them, and we actually wrote the entire song that night.
Well, we played it to a reef, and he went, do you know what jive talking means? And we said, well, yeah, it's, you know, you're dancing. He says, no. I'm putting on this Turkish accent, you see, because this is how he talks. And he says, no, it's a black expression for bullshitting. And we went, oh, really? Jive talking, you're telling me lies. But he gave us the groove, the tempo, everything.
When I first heard Jive Talking, I had no idea it was the Bee Gees.
Everybody went, who? The Bee Gees, Broken Heart Bee Gees? Are you kidding? And that changed our whole career.
With Jive Talkin', the Bee Gees had scored their first number one record in 4 years. Nights on Broadway, the second hit single from the main course album, introduced a key ingredient to the Bee Gees' new sound.
Just done most of the vocal tracks, and usually, you know, at the end, you know, you have some ad-libs or some kind of thing to take us away from the original melody and have some fun, you know. So Barry said, I'll have a go.
I went out there on my own, I experimented, and I started answering, like, blame it all, you know, blame it all. And they, yes, fine, this is just what we were looking for. Okay, let's do more of that. Blame it all, on the night on Broadway, singing them love songs. It was a discovery. We've discovered another element of the group that we can use and use well if we really think about it, you know? It doesn't have to be something I was thinking, my God, I don't, where is this coming from? I can do this. And my whole life I didn't know I could do this. So at that point, because we were so excited about this, we started writing songs for this voice.
Ooh, when we sing songs like, you know how easy it is to hurt me, Fanny be tender. It's Barry and Robin singing in unison. But it sounds like one guy. A bit more Robin, but a bit more Barry. Are you sure? Which one is it? But it's a sound of the two. Then the three of us go into harmony on the Fanny be tender. Fanny be tender. So that blend has been used quite a lot. And it's when we do the harmonies, we bank them underneath with doubles and falsettos on top, so you get the full richness of the harmony.
In 1975, with hits like Fanny Be Tender, the Bee Gees had made a startling comeback, in part due to the production work of Arif Martin. So the brothers were distressed to learn that, for contractual reasons, they would have to make the next album without him. But Martin told the Gibbs not to worry. They could do it on their own, and he was right. Seemingly overnight, the brothers' songwriting had evolved from orchestral pop to a blend of white soul, R&B, and dance music. Children of the World was an enormous success, and the single, You Should Be Dancing, rocketed to number one in the summer of 1976. Determined not to let the momentum slip away, the Bee Gees immediately began writing material for their new album. After a month of hard work, the brothers' creative flow was interrupted by a call from Robert Stigwood. He needed music for a little film he was producing.
We were getting songs ready for our new studio album, which would be the follow-up to Children of the World, and it was imperative that we got that right instead of just, you know, stopping now and doing a few songs for a movie. Unless, of course, we knew it was going to be a huge film, which was no guarantee, of course.
You know, he told us about this guy who works in a paint shop on the other side of the bridge in Brooklyn, you know, and he blows his wages every Saturday night at a club and wins a dance competition. We thought, nice one, Rob.
Those songs were actually written before the film was even mentioned to us. How Deep Is Your Love, If I Can't Have You, Night Fever, Staying Alive, More Than a Woman, all written before we'd seen the film.
And they played me some of the songs that they'd written for Saturday Night Fever. And I couldn't believe that they'd done this. I mean, the stuff was so good. It was fantastic. I thought it was written by somebody else. And I didn't tell them that. Saturday Night Fever score was unique in taking the best of really funky black music and together with very tuneful white music and melding the two things together in a style that was irresistible. Even old men like me would get on the floor and move because you just couldn't stop it.